I'm Coco Novak, author, show host, and public speaker. Welcome to season two of The Coco Novak Show. In this season, we're going to delve deep into what makes us human, relationships, stories of failure that we learn from, and stories of success. It's going to be real, raw, and relatable. So stay tuned, hit that subscribe button, and enjoy. Hi, Rohan. How are you?
Hello, I'm good. Thank you for having me on.
Yeah, you're welcome. Welcome to Tuesday Talks. You are a cybersecurity consultant who works with banks. You've also been a consultant for an online dating app or an ambassador. And today's topic is cybersecurity. So I'm really excited to have you here. Such a massive topic.
Indeed.
I think we've all kind of touched upon some issues there. online scams are kind of prevalent, an up and coming one, or maybe it's been around for a long time, I don't know, romance scams with dating app issues, to the point where banks now have special divisions for romance scams, which we'll talk about in a minute. But yeah, why don't you first tell our viewers and listeners how you got into cybersecurity? And to understand a little bit about where you're coming from.
Sure, absolutely. Firstly, thank you for having me on, Coco. I know we've tried to make this happen a few times. So, I'm glad we got to finally sit down together.
Yes.
So yeah, a bit about me. So I got into cybersecurity mostly because I'm interested in why people commit crime and why people choose to go down a path of criminality versus legality. And that came from when I was studying at university. I studied economics, and as part of my dissertation, I essentially did a study of crime in England and Wales and looked at the data from 15 years and analyzed essentially why do people commit crimes of passion and why do people commit economic or financially motivated crimes. And the main theory from the 1960s, this guy Gary Becker, basically said that all criminals are rational and they weigh up the expected benefits and expected costs of any given crime and make a rational decision on should I go shoplift, should I go rob. So that intuitively didn't make a lot of sense to me for every type of crime. So I studied it looking at, as I said, economic crimes, which are things like fraud and robbery, but also crimes of passion, which are the horrible crimes, right? Murder, rape, etc. And it turns out when you look at the data, economic crimes, Gary Becker's theory stands for that criminals are very rational. They make decisions based on things like likely sentencing, probability of being caught, potential payoff of something like a shoplift or a robbery. But then when it comes to crimes of passion, obviously that doesn't quite hold up as much. So yeah, honestly, just watched a lot of crime shows growing up, ended up doing something related at university. And then when I left, decided to enter the world of cybersecurity.
Amazing. So it's an Excel spreadsheet versus crimes of passion.
Basically. Yeah, exactly.
So tell us what falls under the umbrella of cybersecurity. I'm sure it's quite a large term, but kind of walk us through a little bit so we know what we're talking about.
Yeah, it is indeed. So I guess I'll give you the dictionary definition and then my personal definition. So the dictionary definition would be something like the practice of protecting systems, computers, devices from a cyber attack. Right. And a cyber attack is essentially anyone who's trying to steal information or steal knowledge off a certain process. So let me give you a few examples. We all walk around with smartphones in our pocket. Our smartphones today essentially have everything that we value on them. They have communications with loved ones. They have financial apps. They have photos from the last 10, 20, 30 years. They have almost everything that we value stored on them. Now, imagine if someone who was a malicious actor, let's say, could get that information off your smartphone. That is potentially very damaging personally, financially, etc. And then when we blow that up into a societal level, almost everything that we do today has some sort of nexus in a computer or an online system. So the traffic lights that we drive on roads and we look at traffic lights, those are controlled by computers. The dams that are preventing our villages, our towns, our cities from being flooded are being controlled by computers. The nuclear reactors that are enriching uranium are controlled by computers. So everything that we essentially interact with is controlled by a computer. Now, that's quite scary, actually, in a way. And cybersecurity to me is just protecting all of the digital systems that interact with our physical lives to make sure that essentially our physical lives are safe.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's quite scary when you think that everything is run by computers.
Honestly, when you think really deeply about it, it's hard to find one that isn't, like something that isn't controlled at some level by a computer.
Okay. So you've been a victim of a minor online scam. You were buying trainers. And also, I woke up one day to find more than 20 payments that I had to approve to go through. And I'm like, what's happening? So what happened to you, and kind of what's the story of how we get scammed when we are shopping online? Because that's prevalent.
Yeah, very common scam, yeah. Purchase scam. So my story was I was 18, 19. I saw a pair of, I think they were called Sean Wotherspoon trainers, mm-hmm. these really cool trainers at the time, usually retail at like £500-600. And I saw them for £150-200. Obviously too good to be true. Yeah. I should have thought twice about it, but I thought it was just a lucky find.
Yeah.
So put my card details in, bought them. A week passes, no trainers show up. 2 week passes, no trainers show up. Eventually I realized this was a fake website.
Right.
It looked super legit, had good Trustpilot reviews. I did a little bit of due diligence. I didn't just put my details in. And it turns out that they didn't just want that 200 quid that I was paying for the trainers. I'd put my card details on that site. And my card details weren't encrypted like they usually would be on a kind of secure website. So they could just see my card details. So the smaller scam was them taking the £200 from my account for the trainers. The bigger scam was now they had my card details and they started using those card details to make a whole bunch of other transactions. Now, thankfully, my bank stopped those transactions. They could tell it was from a new device, an unusual location. So there's some ways of them telling that this was fraud. This wasn't me that was making those transactions. But that was my personal story. And a lot of people in this country and globally fall for purchase scams because they're quite a low value, but high volume scam.
And how do these bank details get passed to other people? Because when I was looking at my payments that I hadn't approved, it was just such random stuff. I'm like, okay, this has clearly gone out to, you know, different vendors. So how does that happen?
Yeah, so there's a few ways that kind of bank details and in general personal information is getting into the hands of the criminals. So one way is what's called kind of phishing or smishing, which are these pesky emails and pesky text messages that you're getting, where the fraudsters or cyber criminals are impersonating some sort of trusted entity, right? So it might be Royal Mail saying, oh, we missed a delivery. Can you please just put your details in so that we can redeliver this parcel? It might be your bank calling you up to say, we've seen that there's some unusual traffic and we need to move your money to a safe account. So can we verify this is you? Can you give us some credentials? So there's a lot of different ways that fraudsters can socially engineer or scam that information directly from you. But the other way that it's happening most commonly is through data leaks. So essentially, you provide your information legitimately to lots of organizations, right? So anywhere that you shop, obviously your bank provider, your utility provider, your phone provider, those are all trusted entities. However, when that entity gets hacked, that is a cyber criminal gets into the corporate network, all of a sudden, all of that data goes with it. And that ends up on what's called the dark web, which is essentially the criminal underground. And I actually recently checked for my information on the dark web, and I found dating back to 2013, 2014 was the first traces of my information on the dark web. And just to put that in context, I was about 16, 17 at that point. So I didn't even have a bank account or anything. It was a Neopets address, which is a like online gaming platform, right? So from that age up to now, me being 27, there was about 13 or 15 places where my data had been leaked.
Wow.
And actually, I'd encourage everyone to go and check. There's free tools where you can check where your information is on the dark web. It takes you 5 minutes, but can potentially save you a lot of money and a lot of stress. So definitely worth checking.
Yeah. Interesting. So in series one, episode 17, we had Justin Rose, the district attorney from Los Angeles, telling us there is no African prince
yes.
wanting to give us money.
I can imagine Justin saying that. Me and Justin have played tennis together, so I know what he's like. Yeah.
Also, I was getting a lot of emails at one point that my relative died and they left me a lot of money, and HMRC and the post office, like you've mentioned already. How do these things become global? Like, how does everyone get an email from an African prince?
Right. And that used to be the main scam, actually. It started off like that with these typically Nigerian princes.
Yeah.
They were called 419ers, I think, after the US penal code.
Right. Okay.
419. And they, it's called an advanced fee scam, right? They say, we've got this huge bunch of inheritance that we want to transfer to you, but for you to access that, we need £500, £1,000, whatever it is. And obviously, if you transfer that, there's no big inheritance at the end of it. No. Funnily enough. So as we said, they get the actual email addresses and data from data leaks.
Yeah.
So generally from a corporate network being hacked and then that data being sold on. So there's a whole ecosystem on the criminal underground. One of the players is called an initial access broker. They're the ones who need to actually get into the corporate network.
Right.
But then there's the data broker that just sells on the data. So there's a whole,
it's a whole
marketplace.
Business.
There's a whole supply chain and kind of business model behind it. But once that data is out there, then scammers will just spray and hope, essentially, for some scams, just go scattergun.
Mm.
And interestingly, the same Nigerian group that kind of started off with those inheritance or advanced fee scams have now moved into something a lot more nefarious called financial sextortion. And they're targeting mostly teenagers in Western countries.
Mm.
And they set up fake profiles on Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, essentially trying to pretend to be a love interest to young teenagers and then get them to send explicit photos to the scammers. And then once they have those explicit photos, they will reveal themselves and basically say that we're going to send this to all of your friends unless you pay us X amount by this day. And it's a huge problem for not even teenage, for kids. Let's call them kids because they are kids, right? They're 13, 14, 15 years old. And unfortunately, there have been dozens of suicides in the States because of this scam. So it started very, I guess, in this jokey scam about Nigerian princes. But unfortunately, they have only become more notorious. And it's this group now called the Yahoo Boys, because they started off on Yahoo, that are committing these horrible crimes. But yeah, thankfully, the tech companies have started to do a bit more to kind of crack down on their platforms being exploited for that kind of crime.
Wow. Massive topic, hey? Is there a statistic who gets scammed most? Is it men? Is it women? Is it certain age demographic?
It's a good question. There actually hasn't been a lot of study on scam victimhood. There's been a lot of study on the psychological reasons behind why people get scammed, but not a lot on victimhood analysis. One of the few studies I've seen is from Ireland, where they looked at scam call data and essentially looked at all of the scam calls that happened within Ireland in a certain period, and then looked at things like age, sex, educational background, and what were the different trends between people who got scammed and didn't get scammed. So I can talk to those results. For age and for gender, it was quite interesting, because when I think of who's most likely to get scammed, I think of like my older granny, and that, you know, she doesn't really know how the internet works. She doesn't know how mobile phones work. If someone messaged her claiming to be her grandson and that needed money for a hospital bill, then I can see her believing that that was me, right? Just because she hasn't got the same amount of cynicism that maybe that younger people, right, that have grown up in the digital world. But actually, when you look at the stats, firstly, men are more likely to be scammed.
Wow.
So 2 times more likely than women to be scammed, at least in this Irish study. But interestingly, women lost higher amounts. So men were scammed more often, but women higher amounts. And I think that was just the nature of scams that women were falling for versus men.
Okay.
And then on the age front, again, I thought older cohorts would be more likely to be scammed. But Gen Z and millennials were 13 and 4 times more likely, respectively, to be scammed than their older counterparts. And just thinking about why that was, I think it's just when you live in this digital world, there's so much more opportunity to be scammed if you live online, right?
Yeah.
All of my purchases, all of my communications, they all happen through my phone or my laptop. Mm. So the opportunity for me being defrauded or scammed is a lot higher than maybe my grandma that only knows how to do two things on her smartphone. So yeah, it was interesting that I wouldn't have thought that that was the relationship between kind of victimhood and likelihood to be scammed.
So what do men get scammed for mostly?
So a very common scam at the moment that men are falling for, and typically middle-aged men, is this thing called an investment scam, where essentially someone will reach out to you online, either on social media, through WhatsApp, and claim that they have this really exciting investment opportunity. It might be linked to cryptocurrency, often is linked to cryptocurrency. They will show fake investment returns. They have quite a organized outfit. They even have kind of reference customers that you can speak to on the phone. So there's this whole ecosystem around it to try and convince these men that this is a legitimate opportunity. And often they'll spend months kind of grooming this person into making an initial investment. They have fake apps as well. So these apps show that your investments are going up and to the right. So you invest £100 initially, then you see, wow, overnight it's gone to 200, 250. So they slowly build that trust, and then they go for the longer con or the big payoff, which is transfer 10K, transfer 20K. And now I've got this really, really great opportunity and I don't want you to miss out on it. And that's when they will just disappear off the face of the earth. The app will crash. Whatever profile they were using on social media to contact you will disappear. And obviously that money is also gone. Men tend to fall for that scam more just because of their propensity to chase high returns. And someone actually told me that almost every fraud or scam preys on one or a combination of kind of three base emotions, which is trust, greed, or lust or love. Right. And in the case of investment scams, it's often the greed that you feel that you can get that crazy return in one go. And I don't mean greed in a negative way, because often it's people that are financially quite vulnerable. So they need that to actually, you know, feed their family or pay off their mortgage, for example. So it's not kind of greed in a nefarious way. But yeah, scams really play on our base human emotions.
Interesting. Yeah. Right. Talking about love.
Yes.
We have the romance scams that are up and coming, to the point where banks have their own new departments now to deal with this. So what is a romance scam and how prevalent are they?
Yeah, so romance scams for the last 3 or 4 years have been growing at kind of double-digit percentages across the world. So
they have another name, right?
They do, yes, called pig butchering, and we'll get into what that means. But essentially, a romance scam is someone who online will reach out to you, pretend to be a legitimate love interest, and then at some point will create a sense of urgency that requires you to pay them some amount of money. So it's all about building trust. It's all about finding vulnerable people that can quickly become emotionally attached to someone they've met online, and then eventually exploiting them for financial gain.
Do they end up meeting first, or is it just purely online still when these scams happen?
So the highest propensity of them are only online. There is a very high profile example of one that wasn't. So the Tinder swindler is a common example. There was a Netflix documentary on Simon Leviev, I believe, was the name of the fraudster. Mm-hmm. I think he's walking free, unfortunately.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
But he was actually meeting these women in person. So it was more of a Ponzi scheme where the women would transfer him money and he'd use that money to basically get another woman involved. So he was a serial romance scammer. Most commonly, there will be an online profile, photos that don't actually reflect the real person. Now, with generative AI, it's very easy to just create a fake person. The technology is only going to get better. And then this fake person will try and very quickly build an emotional connection. Love bombing will probably happen quite early on. They will first usually ask for small amounts of money. So it might be £5 for this. Oh, I'm stuck. I don't have any money. I need some money to get home for an Uber. And then they'll actually transfer that money back to you. And it's kind of twofold the reason for that. One, building trust. And two, your bank is very good at finding new accounts that you don't usually transfer money to. So if you just set up a new payee in your bank account and try and transfer them 20K, there is no way your bank will allow that.
Right.
Because they know that is likely a scam. How often are you transferring 20K to someone that you've never transferred any money to, right? So they know they also need to build trust from an algorithmic point of view on the bank side. And so essentially what they do is over a long period of time, usually 2 or 3 months, they will try and build trust and then again go for that big payment of 10, 20, 30,000 pounds potentially before disappearing and their profile going away.
Wow. And what do banks do about it? So if they have their own special divisions now, so if that happens, you know, to me, what do I do?
Yeah.
Do the banks trust me and believe me that this happened, or...
So yeah,
you need some proof or...
Yeah, you're right. They do have special divisions now. And one of the banks that we're working with has a division called Breaking the Spell. So that's the name of the team that essentially calls people that they can see a transactional pattern that looks like a romance scam. Because often it will be, as I said, small payments, then a big payment. And that account might also... the money where the account where the money is flowing to might already be associated with another fraud, right?
Oh, right.
Because they're using the same mule account is what it's called for the proceeds of the crime to go to. So they have some intelligence about what this potential fraudster's account is. And so they will call up the victim and say, hey, we have some pretty strong intelligence to suggest that this is a scam, potentially a romance scam. They'll ask a set of questions. Have you met someone online recently? Have they kind of refused to meet you online? Sorry, refused to meet you in person? Have they love bombed you and essentially tried to build a emotional relationship very quickly? So they'll read out all of the kind of telltale signs of this romance scam and try and convince you that you are in the midst of this happening. And they usually only do that when they're pretty sure, by the way. You can imagine being pretty confused as a customer if you're trying to transfer money to your friend or your family, right?
And I'm getting all these questions.
Yeah. So they usually do it when they're pretty sure.
Right.
And at the end of the day, it's still up to the customer. It's your money. It's your legal right to that money and to transfer that money. So they can only warn you so much.
Hmm.
And then if you still want to go ahead with it, then the money will be transferred. Now, the interesting thing is the regulation is changing on October 7th. So the type of fraud we're talking about is called authorized fraud, because you, the person who actually owns that money and owns that account, is making the transfer, which is really hard to detect from a fraud point of view, a technology problem, because if you imagine you actually sending money to a fraudster, Coco would be using her real device.
Mm-hmm.
Coco would be authenticating it with either her fingerprint or her face. She would be putting in all her correct PIN codes. So there's nothing from an authentication point of view that looks weird. But the regulation is now changing that banks are going to be on the hook for any losses that even happen from authorized fraud, which basically is coming in because the government is stepping in to say, we are at a point where this is an epidemic. They're calling it a scamdemic, in fact. 40% of all crime is fraud in the UK, compared to something like 20% for Sweden and much lower for other countries. So in the UK specifically, we have a real problem around scams. And they've stepped in to say, even if it isn't a piece of authorized fraud and Coco has approved this transaction, you, the bank, need to refund her 100% and make her whole. Now, there's one small little caveat in there, which is if the customer is grossly negligent, then you do not need to fully refund them. So we don't...
So you're doing it over and over again.
Exactly. Yeah. So we don't really know what grossly negligent means yet, because it's yet to become law. But
I
think it's good for the customer. It's very, very good for the customer. The banks aren't happy about it, but
But how readily do people admit that they've been kind of romance scammed? So I recently heard a friend was telling me this, that they know someone who had this relationship with someone abroad and they were about to meet. It was actually a woman scamming a guy, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And then her mother, all of a sudden became ill and now she needed money and he was sending her this money. And the bank called him up and said, listen, she's not ill. She doesn't have an ill mother. This is a scam. And he was like, no, we're in love. So how difficult is it for people sometimes to understand that they're actually being scammed?
Yeah, there's a huge...
I mean, if a bank calls you up, you'd want to believe them, I think.
You definitely would want to believe them. There's a huge stigma around it, unfortunately. Mm. It's not a crime that's talked about very openly. There's a kind of sense of shame, I think, that comes from the victim side of thinking that you've been conned. Whereas it's so common that actually there just shouldn't be that stigma associated with being defrauded.
I think you always think that you're the only one when you get scammed.
Right. Yeah. And as we just discussed, you know, 40% of all crime in this country is fraud. So there's definitely a huge pool of people out there. There's support groups out there. Mm. Unfortunately, even in the UK, 300 people commit suicide a year because of after a fraud event. So it might
it's
be a romance.
Actually.
Right. Which might be a romance scam, might be investment scam. It's usually a very high emotional and financial impact of some of these scams. So, yeah, you want to trust your bank. The problem is that even banks can be impersonated. So
yeah, true.
Often you get a call on your phone and you'll check the number on your phone and it will be your bank's number because the fraudsters are using spoofing technology where you can just impersonate a number. So I got a call a couple of weeks ago. I was driving. I got a call from American Express.
Right.
And they said that my card had been used in kind of a few fraudulent transactions. And this was the fraud team that was checking in. So I quickly went on my app and checked, like, okay, I usually will never get a call from Amex. Why are they calling me? I'm sure this is a fraudster. And I checked and I actually saw there were some fraudulent transactions on my phone. So I said, okay, maybe they're being serious. So I went along with it, partly because I work in fraud and I just want to see what's going on.
How far they go.
Right. But let me also try to find out what the criminals are doing these days, right? So I was getting slowly more and more convinced that maybe this was American Express. They were giving me information that only my bank, I thought, would know about my transactional history. But then they started asking me about what other accounts I had and could I move money to my Monzo or Revolut. And then that's when I knew that this definitely wasn't the bank itself that was calling me. Then I read the newspaper the next day and I read about a mum that had lost £68,000 to this exact same scam from American Express. She was at bath time with her two kids, literally bathing her kids. This fraudster obviously created a sense of emergency that, you know, your credit card is being used and it's going to max your limit. We need to move all of your money from your other accounts to protect your savings. And she did it and she lost £68,000. So anyone can fall for it, honestly. They use really sophisticated techniques. People in counter fraud and cybersecurity fall for scams all the time. So yeah, I'm not surprised that people that aren't living and breathing this every day fall for these scams because they are very sophisticated.
Okay. So just walk us through the pig butchering very quickly.
Yes.
We mentioned it. We didn't say what it was.
Yeah. So pig butchering is a mix between a romance scam and an investment scam. And we've already kind of talked about both. So I won't go into what those are. But the interesting and really sad thing about pig butchering is that the scammers are also victims in themselves. So there are these huge scam compounds in Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia, which are filled with people that have been trafficked from usually China and India on the promise of a job opportunity. So it's a fake job opportunity. They are trafficked to these countries, their passports are taken away, and they're told that all day long they need to essentially perpetrate these scams. And that means messaging people on WhatsApp, pretending to be love interests, and then getting them into a crypto or investment scheme. And then, of course, as soon as the money is extracted, they disappear. But unfortunately, even these people that are doing the scams, they've lost their passport. They're only being compensated if they actually are successful in the fraud. So it's this kind of vicious cycle of kind of human trafficking, modern slavery, fraud and money laundering all happening at the same time. And unfortunately, those governments are taking a cut. So the police forces are in on it. Everyone knows where these scam centers are. You can look at satellite images of this famous one called Sonakville. You can actually see over kind of 400 different huge buildings of people just filled with scammers and scam compounds. And there's a whole world in there of shops and prostitutes and all kinds of stuff that goes on in this scam compound. It's kind of a lawless society.
Right.
But unfortunately, you know, Western governments can't do much about it because it's out of their jurisdiction and out of their control. But yeah, it's a bit of a weird name, pig butchering. And I think it's because the scammers are trying to fatten up the victim that they call the pig,
right,
to then butcher them, yeah, i.e. get that big payment at the end of the investment scam. Horrible term, yeah.
Mind-blowing. So what can we do as ordinary consumers, kind of on an everyday basis? Because we've just heard that it's massive. It can happen anytime. We're on our computers, our phones all the time. So what can we do to minimize getting scammed, basically?
Yeah, good question.
Are there any red flags that kind of tend to come up? Any, I don't know, maybe phrases that they use, something like that?
Yeah, so I think there are a few common red flags across all of these different scams. I think the sense of urgency is definitely a big one, where whether it's romance or whether it's investment scam, there'll always be something that means the money needs to be transferred now, within kind of 5 seconds, 5 minutes, right? They try and create this real sense of urgency so you don't think too much. And that would be my biggest advice, actually, is stop and think. And there's this big campaign that's going on at the moment about stop, take five, which is just whenever you're about to make a big transaction, just take 5 minutes to think about it. And I'd go one step further, speak to a trusted friend or family member, because that's always a great sense check. Yeah. There would be so many cases that would be stopped by someone just quickly having a chat with a friend or having a chat with a family member. But unfortunately, when there is that sense of urgency, people do things that they normally wouldn't. So I think that's one, the sense of urgency. Yeah. And then two, unfortunately, we just need to be a little bit more cynical. And it's not a nice thing to say, because, you know, we kind of rely on trust as society to get on and kind of do anything and function. But we have to be cynical. We have to have that stranger danger that we have in real life with people we meet digitally and on the internet. I think sometimes because we're behind a mobile phone or a computer screen, we don't feel that kind of impeding danger. And I think we need to have a little bit more skepticism about the people that we meet online, which is potentially why online dating, by the way, is going through such a rough period at the moment and apps aren't being used as much. I think just that trust from digital technology is really going down, not just because of fraud, but of quite a few reasons.
Interesting. Hey, Rohan, thank you so much for all this info. Is there anything that you would like to leave our guests, or not our guests, that's you, our viewers and listeners, with maybe a tip or something like that?
I think just what I said earlier in the program, actually, if you have one thing that you could do today, take 5 minutes and check on the dark web of where all your information is, because literally that free check, 5 minute check, you will see where your passwords are, where your addresses are, and where any sensitive information of yours is. And often it's a lot of stuff that you would have not have thought about, like a Ticketmaster account from years ago, or like an Ocado account from years ago. So random places that would have been leaked, but that password that you use for Ticketmaster is also your HSBC password. And so if you know that just exists on the internet and criminals can see it, then you can go and change your passwords and secure those accounts. So yeah, if you have one thing to do today, just do that quick check. It could save you a lot of money and a lot of stress.
Rohan Mer, thank you so much for being my guest.
Thank you for having me on. Really enjoyed the conversation.
Good, me too.